Thank you so much for joining us for our next keynote session at New Orleans Entrepreneur Week. We are so excited to be in the ninth year of celebrating entrepreneurship and innovative thinking in the city of New Orleans. This next keynote speaker was brought down as a result of a partnership with Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses. On behalf of the Idea Village, we'd like to thank Goldman Sachs for their partnership and support of New Orleans Entrepreneur Week. I'm now happy to introduce David Payton, Executive Director of Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program at Delgado Community College, who will introduce our next keynote speaker.
So good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. So again, my name is David Payton, and I have the esteemed privilege of actually leading a very, very sharp group of professionals at Delgado Community College that deliver the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program in the South Central region. We're one of 13 locations around the United States that deliver this high impact program to entrepreneurs, and we're right here on Delgado Community College's campus. Tell you a little bit about the program. The program is a 13 to 15 week fast track boot camp for business owners. It's paid for by the Goldman Sachs Foundation at no cost to the business owner. And the program, what we do is we teach you in this short amount of time how to scale your business, how to grow your revenue, how to gain control of your business, and how to create jobs out of it. The impact from this program is phenomenal. What I will tell you this as well, we're trying to show business owners how to work more on their business and be strategic than work in their business. So again, the impact, phenomenal. 69% of the people that actually come through our program within 16 months report that they see revenue growth. 45% of them actually create new jobs. Within 30 months of them actually leaving the program, 82% of the people are reporting revenue growth with a 60% job creation ratio. So first thing I want to do is share a little something with you about the successes of the program and the successes of some of the business owners that came through the program. I'm going to share with you this short video.
The Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses Program is a guide that will help you grow your business.
The networking through the Goldman Sachs program is something that you cannot buy.
Through the program, you meet other people that have the same challenge that you do, so you don't feel alone.
You meet other local businesses that you can share your thoughts, feelings, issues, problems, and how you work through those problems as a business owner.
Networking, to me, is one of the most important ingredients for success in a small business. The network that I've developed through Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses has been extraordinary, not only for leads for my business, but also for companies that I have partnered with.
Before the program, you thought another restaurant owner was your competition. But then once you start sharing and networking, you realize that everybody has the same problem. They're just twisted a little different, you know?
To get the opportunity to sit in class with 29 other entrepreneurs, pushing back on your ideas and showing you where, hey, you may be a little weak here. Maybe you can refine this here. Where do you see the weakness? Where can I help you?
There's a comfort working with someone who has gone through the same program as you. We're all on the same page, and it's a wonderful working relationship.
Since the program, anytime I need something, the first place I look is my book to see who else I can call that provides a service or a business that I need.
I do business with 12 people from my class. And I also do business with other people from other classes.
Teresa Lawrence with Delta Personnel and I have been working together. She's got a labor force and we contact her when we need additional laborers. And it's a wonderful contact to have that person you can reach out to and say, hey, I need help.
Barrett Wiley with Cleaning Concierge actually cleans our offices.
Our pet control is down from another small business that was in the program with us. And sometimes I do my hair from with Mandy, which she was in the program too, so.
I'm working hand in hand with no less than 10 of my classmates. Comex Construction, XS Martial Arts Dojo, Demo Diva. We formulated relationships now to where it's really not even about pricing. It's just about, I'm going to support your business because you're supporting my business.
The trust level that you built with this network of people that are in your cohort is inseparable.
So folks, you heard the word network as well. 85% of the people that actually come through our program do business with each other. So again, this program is free to business owners, and we want to invite you guys to apply. If you go to our website, 10ksbapply.com, you actually can find out more about the program. And again, our next program we're recruiting for is going to start in September. It's about 15 weeks. We're looking forward to seeing you guys come through. You know, we're proud of the footprints of success that we've actually created in this region through this program and across the nation. But to accomplish this mission, we don't do this alone. You know, we team up with some very strong partners to make sure that this program has the brand recognition and gets out there, and folks like yourselves know about the program, namely like the Idea Village. We've been supporters of the Idea Village, Delgado Community College, and the Goldman Sachs program, and we're going to continue to work with them. We've actually teamed together to put on one class for earlier phase businesses that we typically we usually deal with more advanced businesses. But thank you to the Idea Village and to NOEW Week for putting this event on. So I also want to say that, having said that and telling you a little bit about the program. So as you know, we're enthused about growing businesses around here. But we're also excited to hear from another entrepreneur on his journey. Patrick Lee is a serial entrepreneur who's been either a founder or co-founder of a wealth of companies in the entertainment and tech sectors, perhaps the most notably, Rotten Tomatoes. I'm pleased to introduce Patrick Lee, co-founder of Rotten Tomatoes and Hobo Labs, and Mike Belikov. He's a noted freelance business journalist and a book author whose credits include Entrepreneur Magazine, Success, and Forbes, among others. Patrick and Mike, I welcome you to the stage.
Good morning, everybody. Can you hear me okay? Hi, I'm Michael Belikov, and it's my pleasure to welcome Patrick to the stage for one of the, I think we're like the third or fourth last talk here at New Orleans Entrepreneur Week that's of a keynote nature. I know you're really busy and you just got into town last night. I'm going to be asking you some questions that help our audience members understand your journey, what's going on at Hobo Labs and why that matters. I've also sourced some questions from entrepreneurs and entrepreneur wannabes that aren't able to be here that have some questions for you as well. But let's get started. I'd like to just first ask you why you wanted to be a part of New Orleans Entrepreneur Week.
Okay. So I met Emily from Idea Village in San Francisco at an event through my friend Jay, who's speaking here, Jay Zhao. And then she told me about this conference. I thought it was really interesting, and I've never been to New Orleans, so I really wanted to come check it out. I like to kind of meet other entrepreneurs, and I thought it'd be a good chance to just kind of see what the entrepreneurship landscape is here.
Yeah. So what time did you get in yesterday?
Around 5 or 6 p.m.
Okay. And have you had much of a chance yet to look around, or is that part
of
your stay?
I didn't want to go out last night before today's talk, but I did go downstairs from the hotel I was in, and they had like a jazz band playing, so that was cool.
Yeah, it's a hustling, bustling area. In fact, I think the hotel where you and I are staying in is developed by someone who won an award earlier this week as one of New Orleans's most leading entrepreneurs. So on that note of getting to know you a little bit, would you take us through your journey from high school, quite literally, to this stage? Where did you go to college? Where did you grow up? And I know there have been a number of organizations along the way, but in the limited time that we have, just to get us started, Tell us about your journey and what led you here today.
Okay, sure. So I was actually born in LA, but I grew up in Maryland. I went to school, high school over there, magnet program, you know, learning computer science, math, science, et cetera. Went to school out in Berkeley, in California.
Was the magnet program your choice? Or was it your parents' choice?
They had me go take a test, and they're like, if you can get in, then we'll take you to Disney World. And I was like, okay.
Nice.
And then I moved to Berkeley, went to school over there. I left school after about 2 years in to do a computer, selling computer systems and components, a company called Human Ingenuities. I convinced three friends to leave school with me. So we started doing that. We were selling them out of our apartment. People would order the parts or order a computer. We would drive down to the South Bay, which was about an hour drive, buy the parts, go back to our apartment, build it. From there, I ended up doing a web design company called Design Reactor. We were focused, originally we were doing it for everybody, but very quickly we realized, like, hey, we want to focus on entertainment. And so we switched over to that. We ended up doing a lot of work for Disney Channel, ABC, Warner Brothers, Artisan Entertainment, just a lot of entertainment-related companies.
How did those relationships get established? Because there are a lot of people that started web companies that are still toiling around helping their aunts and uncles build sites. You jumped right in and were working with some major corporations. What was the business development effort that led to that?
Okay, so I guess two things that were kind of interesting with that company. First is when we started, we were doing it like everything for everyone. So we did not just web design, but we were like, let's do 3D videos, let's do print design. And very quickly after we started, we realized like, okay, 3D stuff back then, this is mid-90s, it like you would have to render every computer in the office would have to render the entire night to like just see a little bit of video. And we realized like this is really hard to do because it just takes so much power, computing power. Print design also took a lot of resources to like when the files are very big that you had to print out, plus you have to like deliver 2 weeks in advance to the printers to get an actual printout to see if it looks right, like the colors actually match. And so at that time with the web, it was very slow, like even, you know, you try and keep web pages to like 20K, you know, even 100K web page was, for one page, was considered like huge.
Yeah, the bandwidth,
up
by the user on their side couldn't handle what you may have wanted to design.
Right, right. So we realized like, well, because we're working with such small files, like your computer could handle it back then. And so, and you can make a change, like they want to change, you could change it in 5 minutes and just upload it. So we thought, okay, let's focus down to just web design. And then on the other side, we were doing stuff for like, the initial sites we were doing were like dentist site, you know, random tech company, things like that. And the way we got into entertainment was actually kind of a roundabout way where we ended up meeting someone who was in the tech side. We were helping them with their website. But he had a daughter who was working at Disney Channel. This person, Larry Barber, he had a daughter, Kara Barber, and he was like, why don't you come to, I think it was Comdex in Las Vegas, I can introduce you to other, you know, tech companies so you can try and see if you can help them with their websites. I can also introduce you to my daughter. And so when we went there, we met up with her and she was like, we just let go of our lead developer for Disney Channel. And the reason why they did that was, I guess some disgruntled employee at that design firm put a curse word in or something that somehow made it through like three levels of QA and went live. And with Disney, that's a no-go. So they're immediately canned. And so she was like, yeah, so we're actually looking for other developers. And we're like, wow, that's amazing.
And what year was this when Disney was doing this? They were outsourcing their web design. What year was that?
This was, I think, around 97, 98, something, yeah. Probably 97. And so we were like, this is amazing. We should definitely try and get in. But none of our portfolio, nothing would be really useful for Disney. Like a random motherboard website is not going to be attracted to them. So what we ended up doing was, as soon as I got back, I called like all my friends that I knew could like code or, you know, make games or do art. And I said, hey, can you please come in? So I got like, I think it was like 15 people. And I said, we have an opportunity maybe to try and make something for them because we don't have a portfolio, like, let's make a website to show them what we can do. So we went onto the Disney Channel site. We looked around at their schedule, like what shows are playing or coming up. And we're like, okay, they don't have a website for this movie called Mighty Ducks 2. And so we rented the movie. We all watched the movie. And then we built a fully functioning website with, you know, two Flash games, icons, wallpapers, bios, et cetera, in like one weekend. It's like 3 days or something, just super quick turnaround. And we sent it over to her and we're like, look, we don't have a portfolio that matches what you would be looking for, but we made this in to kind of show you what we can do. And she was just like, oh my God, like, there's no possible way you could have done this in advance of meeting. So she knew how fast we can turn around. And the thing is, we didn't know the Disney, like Disney style guide, so it didn't really match their style exactly, but they ended up actually buying the two games. And I think at the time, they bought the two games for $12,500. And we had to, you know, obviously fix it up and stuff. But up to that point, we were doing websites for like $5,000 right. or so. And so ever since that point, we're just like, okay, let's just focus on entertainment. That's more interesting.
So when, and this is that design rector, right? Mm-hmm. And these 15 people that came in, did a number of them end up staying on board and getting other contracts and staying with you for quite a while?
Yeah, so once we got that contract, they ended up, you know, after we delivered the games, they're like, well, we need some more sites. Like, can you do this and this? And they throw a contract here or there. And later on, they even had a person come in to kind of take over as the director, this guy, Brian Bowman. And he had us come in to meet with him. And he's like, you guys are a bunch of kids. Why should we give you so much work? And I said, look, we grew up with this stuff, with the internet. I mean, if you're hiring at that time, you know, someone in their 40s or whatever, this is all like kind of new to them, relative. Like, at that point, we were low 20s, and we're like, this is, we grew up with this, but we're also better, faster, cheaper, more creative than any of those groups. And he was like, yeah, that sounds about right. And then we ended up actually taking over and doing almost all of Disney Channel's work. Like, we ended up getting like $1 million maintenance contract with them because we just kept growing and growing and kept throwing more stuff to us because they knew we could handle it. And then what would happen was at Disney Channel, they had very fast turnover. So those people would leave after a while, the producers, and they would go to other places like MTV and VH1 and ABC, Warner Brothers, and they would take us with them because they knew that we could do things very fast and cheap and everything so that we could make them look good.
Now watch this. Here's the interesting part. You went to Cal Berkeley. Your major was?
Cognitive science.
Cognitive science, not computer science, not graphic design. What was your role at Design Rector? What did you do while people were being wicked programmers and designers? What was your role?
I was basically the guy who does whatever's needed to get done. A lot of it, though, would be either like kind of sales, business development, like trying to get more work. But when we did get the jobs, I would act more like a producer to help try and make sure it got delivered on time.
Right. Now, here's what's interesting. Nowadays, you'll find a lot of agencies like Design Rector that are finding that the capabilities that they have in-house, a lot of firms and a lot of companies now have in-house as well. It's 14, 17 years later. Firms like Disney and others, they can do what you do in-house. Some of them can't. Some of them still rely on outsourcing. But a lot of these agencies are now turning around and starting to do the entrepreneurial route themselves using the talent that they have in-house. You did that back in the early 2000s. One of your co-founders at Design Rector broke away and had a little side project. And that side project was?
Rotten Tomatoes. So yeah, actually what happened was our creative director at our design firm, he came up with the idea on the side. He was a big movie buff. And the basic way he came up with it was, you know, back in the day, you'd open up a newspaper. They would have these full-page ads, which would look like a movie poster with quotes on them. And all the quotes would be good, regardless if the movie was actually good or not. If the movie was good, the quotes would be from very good critics, like Roger Ebert. But if the movie was bad, they would be from like random radio station DJ, who's not actually a real movie critic, you know. But his idea was just like, well, what if I do the same thing, but put all the quotes from all the official critics, you know, good and bad, and then kind of have a score.
And so it started as a side project for him. But then your group at Design Rector took a look at it and said, there's a bigger opportunity here. And so the full force of your firm really kind of got turned around and focused on the Rotten Tomatoes brand and turned it into a business. What kind of resources did you bring to bear that took it from a hobby to a real business?
So we, let's see. We helped host it for about a year for him. The creator was Sen Duong. And we could see that the traffic was growing, and it was all organic. We weren't buying traffic or anything like that. And after about a year, we said, maybe we should try running this as a business. And so we essentially talked to Sen. He was just doing it on the side. And he couldn't really grow past a certain point because he just didn't have the money or the team. He wasn't an engineer, so he, you know, was coding everything, making static HTML pages. And so we decided to join forces, brought him on board. So we all became, myself, Sen, and my co-founder Steven, who's our CTO, became like co-founders of both Design Reactor and Rotten Tomatoes. We ended up then passing our design firm off to another group to take over because we were worried that if we tried to do both, every time there was a big deadline on the design side, we'd end up pulling all the resources over. So we said, let's have someone else handle that. Then we went out, raised $1 million for Rotten Tomatoes, January 2000.
And what was your role in raising those funds? Were you out there on the street giving pitches, or was your role more of an operational role at Rotten Tomatoes?
So between the three of us, Sen was the creator. He handled the product. He basically was anything with like from the movie side, working with critics, et cetera. Steven was the CTO, handled revamping the site, putting everything in a database, licensing data in to integrate. And I was like strategy, business development, fundraising, investor relations, hiring, everything else that was needed.
So 2004 rolls along. The bubble has crashed, but you have survived. And Rotten Tomatoes gets sold. What happens then?
So we sold in 2004. And after we sold, so stepping back real quick, I left after 2 years of school, but actually over the next 10 years, I was taking classes here and there, summer classes, et cetera. So after we sold, I decided to go back and finish because I was like really close to graduating. So overall, it took me 12 years to get my undergrad degree. And then after we sold, being like an American-born Chinese, I wanted to see what it was like in Asia. So I actually ended up moving to China for 3 years to do a startup there. A company called, originally it was called Shaban, and it was like kind of like a Yelp type of business. But it wasn't totally working where we were, and we ended up buying a community site instead called XMFish that was like forums, very popular in that region, and focused on that. And then after 3 years, I ended up moving to Hong Kong, doing a site called Alive Not Dead that was like a MySpace type of thing, working with celebrities and artists over there to connect to their fans.
Alive Not Dead.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what ended up happening with that site?
We ran it for 6 years. Basically, the way that one started was I had a friend who went to Hong Kong just to kind of check out the handover when his sister was like a VJ there. She kind of got him some work. He ended up becoming like one of the biggest movie stars in Asia. This guy named Daniel Wu, he's starring in a TV show now called Into the Badlands on AMC now. So he was an actor, but he wanted to direct. And so one time him and his other friend came and pitched me and they're like, hey, here's an idea for a movie we want to make. And I basically put some funds in. Like, it was very low cost. And essentially, it was four actors that made a boy band called Alive, only one of which could sing. And they actually went and made music videos, had concerts, et cetera. But the whole idea is they actually did this for real, but they were filming it all for about 2 years. Then they actually made a mockumentary talking about the state of the entertainment industry over in Asia, where how can you have these four, like, 30-something-year-old actors make a boy band and for people to actually accept them and for them to be popular. And the movie is called Heavenly Kings. And so after that movie came out, we were talking and they're like, well, we would still want to do, so the website, the reason why it's called Alive Not Dead was, well, they couldn't get alive.com, but they wanted a site for the band. And it was just a site for the band, but afterwards we're like, maybe we can make it more because they wanted to be like, well, it's not enough to just make commentary, like negative commentary about the entertainment industry, but maybe we can support it. So we tried to make the site very supportive for artists.
And did that business eventually get sold as well?
Yeah, so we, after 6 years, you know, we were going to try and raise money in 2008. I think we started in 2007. Market crashed. And so we ended up just not raising money. Myself and my co-founder, Steven, just kept putting in money. And after 6 years, it was growing in the beginning, but then it kind of leveled off and even started tapering because we not only were competing with like social media kind of companies in Asia, but also in the US. So you had like Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, but also the Chinese like Weibo, Weixin, which were like the Chinese Twitter, et cetera.
So here we are in 2017. Since that time, you've obviously come back to the States. You started another business called Hobo Labs. First, what is Hobo Labs?
So we make mobile games for iOS, Android. We've released like one test game called Puzzle Arcana, but we're working on our real game. We've spent over 2 years on it, and it is a synchronous multiplayer game, meaning you can play with your friends at the same time, and it has both PvE, player versus environment, so fighting monsters, et cetera, as well as PvP, like player versus player, fighting other players.
And when will that game be out?
Hopefully in a couple months.
Okay. And the name of the game?
Storm the Gates.
Storm the Gates. Why Hobo Labs, the name Hobo Labs?
Okay, so I had my friend Lyle, who is one of there's four of us that did our first company together right out of school. Lyle is one of those co-founders. After
Lyle founded Lithium Technologies?
Yeah, so after we stopped and I went to go do the design firm in Rotten Tomatoes, Lyle ended up with his brother, so Lyle Fong, Dennis Fong, they ended up starting a company called Gamers.com. Also very early, they raised like, I think 14 million, but then when the market crashed, they were burning like $1 million a month and they couldn't raise anymore. Went out of business, they spun out two companies, Xpire, his brother spun out Xpire, which ended up selling to, I think it was Viacom or something for like 100 million, and that was like messaging for games. And then his brother's now doing something called Raptor. And Lyle ended up doing a company called Lithium Technologies, which spun out the bulletin board kind of system that they had for gamers. Lithium ended up raising like 150 million, 500 employees. So after I got back from Asia, I was hanging out a lot with Lyle because he was kind of transitioning out of Lithium. He came to me and he was like, hey, let's do another enterprise company. And I said, well, after Lithium, you don't ever need to work again. Why don't you just retire? But if you want to do something new, don't do another enterprise company. You've already done that. Do something for fun or do something crazy. For fun, like make a band, write a book, make a game, or crazy like SpaceX or Tesla, you know? So he came back a couple weeks later and he's like, why don't we make games? We were always gamers since like forever. And I'm like, okay, let's do that. So the reason why it's called Hobo Labs is before we ended up actually doing the company, we were traveling around a lot, and because we both at the time weren't really working, he used to joke that we were like hobos because you're traveling around without a job. And so when we were originally starting, he already had GX Labs from the URL from when he was doing Gamers. So originally when we pitched, we were GX Labs, and I'm like, well, what does GX even mean for us? We're not gamers.com or anything like that. And so we were just running through ideas and names, and we thought the idea of Hobo Labs sounded funny because you don't normally associate like hobos in a laboratory.
Got it. Okay. So with that as the backdrop, we know where you started from. We know how you got to this stage and why you're here. You know, depending upon whose statistics you believe, between 70 to 90% of all entrepreneurial efforts fail. The exceptions are especially the ones that are associated with Goldman Sachs and their 10,000 program, where people are tied into resources and there's a certain accountability. You don't see those kind of numbers there. But there's this mystique of the entrepreneur in general. And I've spent the last 7 years interviewing entrepreneurs for books and articles, and I sort of buy into the mystique sometimes myself and have to remember that the wicked coders, the ones that went to Cal Berkeley, for example, the ones that are in Silicon Valley, that's just a small percentage of who the entrepreneurial set is. That, you know, the next entrepreneurial success is really defined by how someone defines success themselves. So it could be a plumber. It could be someone who's running a lawn maintenance company. It doesn't have to be somebody who's, you know, just doing a tech kind of startup. And that's one of the things that I find really interesting about what New Orleans is doing with Entrepreneur Week. It's not just reaching out to the tech community, but it's reaching out to the neighborhoods and saying, there's a lot of side hustle that's going on here. There are a lot of people that are entrepreneurs on their own that aren't tapping into any resources. They're probably not paying any local taxes either. They don't have a federal employment tax identification number, but they're doing something and they're tapping into something that's really interesting and really unique. My question here is that what advice would you give to those entrepreneurs? Because if entrepreneurship means I have to be as successful as Facebook is, as Rotten Tomatoes was, a lot of people won't even start, right? Because they don't know how to get from inception to where that is. So for everyone else that doesn't have sort of gobbles of cash already to invest in a business, they don't have a success story already, they don't have investors who like what they did last time, and so they're willing to invest in their next development, what tips or what warnings can you give to those people that have an idea and have the same amount of enthusiasm for the idea as you've had for yours?
Wow, okay. So I have a lot of general feedback about if you're thinking about doing a startup. I mean, there's a lot of things that you would want to look at. One is opportunity cost. So when you are younger, you're straight out of school, generally, you know, you're not married, you don't have kids, you don't have house payments, car payments. It's a lot safer at that point to kind of jump into a startup versus if you're in your 30s or 40s and you have all those things. Just because you're giving up a lot more, you're taking on a lot more risk to yourself. One thing with being an entrepreneur, I think it doesn't matter what type, like what kind of company you're running or business you're running, you make mistakes. And it takes, I would say, usually like 3 years of just lots and lots of mistakes before you kind of figure things out with your business. So again, going back to opportunity cost, if you're younger, you can afford to make mistakes for 3 years. If you're older, it's a little bit tougher because, you know, a year in, 2 years in, your spouse is probably not gonna let you keep trying to keep doing your business. So that's one thing I definitely have people consider when they're thinking about doing it. Another thing is the personality of an entrepreneur. There's a famous author, sports author, called Bill Simmons, and he came up with a term called irrational confidence. I think referencing like basketball players, when the people, when it's like fourth quarter, not much time left, they want the ball and they're gonna shoot it, even if they've missed like the last 10 shots. So with entrepreneurs, I feel like that's one thing I've seen with everyone who's done really well and has been quite successful as an entrepreneur is they have irrational confidence. Like everyone you meet is gonna say no. You know, even if you talk to me and I'd be like, oh, well, you're married with kids, blah, blah, like the stuff I was just talking about, oh, maybe you shouldn't do it. But someone with irrational confidence, they'll get that no, they'll get the no, they'll get it over and over and over, but they'll keep pushing forward regardless of what investors or people they're trying to hire or their potential customers all say no, like 90-something percent will probably say no. They keep going. And like a really good example is, you know, when you think about like Steve Jobs, they said he had a reality distortion field. He was so good at convincing these people into seeing his reality. And that's something you see with these entrepreneurs who have that irrational confidence to get people to like leave their jobs to join with them, either as a co-founder or employee, to get people to try their product when they're just starting out. So that's another one that I think is really important.
Going back to your first one where you said there's more of an opportunity when you're a little bit younger to fail, to learn from it and move on. When it comes to raising money, either from experienced angels or even further on, if you're in a Series A round, what do those failures say about you, and how do you overcome that in the face of someone who says, well, you've already tried this for 3 or 4 years and you haven't done much. What makes you think throwing money at it is going to solve it? What's the response to that?
Well, I think when you're trying to raise money, really probably the biggest thing that people are going to look for is whether or not you've gotten traction. Traction meaning like shown real growth in revenue or traffic if you're like a website or an app, as well as revenue, traffic, brand, engagement.
Users.
So those kind of numbers. So if you've been doing it a while and you're showing that like, hey, people are actually trying to use this product, they really want that product, that's the best. That reduces the risk for the investors the most. But in the valley, failure, even like, not necessarily like, hey, my company's failed for 3 years and you're trying to raise money, like that's obviously very hard because you probably haven't shown much traction. But if it was like, I did a company or two that failed, but now I'm trying to do this new thing, at least in the valley, they respect that you actually try to do a company because most people, almost everyone you meet, everyone's thinking about doing a company. It's like Hollywood with everyone trying to be an actor or director. But how many of them actually jump in and do it is very low. So that part people actually do respect. I don't know about the rest of the country or rest of the world. Like in Asia, they don't necessarily like failure. they think it looks really bad, so they're very afraid to take risk. Yeah.
Got it. So in my experience, the entrepreneurs that I've interviewed, they tend to fall into one of two very broad categories, and I realize I'm gross generalizing here. They're either very confident, well-spoken, or they're a bit shy and introverted. You yourself are a self-admitted introvert. What advice can you offer for others when it comes to networking? Because that's what really does lead to opportunity.
Right, so, yeah, even though I'm on stage right now, I'm actually, yeah, quite introverted. For a long time, I would not do any public speaking at all. It terrified me. I actually forced myself to get better by taking some acting classes, like 2-day intensive acting classes, not to be an actor, but to try and deal with my fear of public speaking. For me, at least, with public speaking, I forced myself a couple times to do it, and after a while, it started getting easier and easier. It's like if you are afraid of riding a roller coaster, and someone straps you onto a roller coaster and just forces you to ride the same one 20 times. The 20th time, you're probably going to be less scared of it than the first time that you did it. But as far as networking goes, there's a lot of tips there. You don't have to be, like, for me even now, if you threw me at a party where I knew nobody, I would still probably be the guy standing in the corner, you know, playing on his phone or something. But you don't have to network that way necessarily. There's a lot of ways to do it outside of that. Like, some simple tips would be, like, go with friends who already maybe know some people at that event or party, and make sure before you go that all you and your friends actively introduce anyone you meet or know to each other. Then you end up meeting everyone that your entire group knows and meets. That's super easy, because if someone introduces you to someone else, it's much easier to talk to them than just going up and saying, like, hey, I'm Patrick, how are you doing? There's a lot of other things, simple tips. One I find very important is follow up with people. Typically, you hand out 10 business cards, how many people write back to you who get those business cards? How many people do you write to? Probably most people is like 1 out of 10. I do like 10 out of 10 or 9 out of 10. I mean, if someone just walks up to me and hands me a card and walks away, like, I don't follow up with that person. But if we talked a little bit, I will follow up and I say, hey, it's nice to meet you. Maybe connect with them on LinkedIn. If we really got along, maybe connect with them on Facebook. And if I think, oh, there's someone interesting or whatever, I might say, why don't we follow up for a coffee? That way, you have your first time you meet them at the event or whatever, the email follow-up, that's the second time you connect. If you get coffee with them afterwards, it's the third time you connect. By that time, you will remember who they are, they will remember who you are. But if you just meet them at a party, you hand them a card, both of you go home and throw it away, what's the point? Why did you even go to that event? As some simple examples.
Yeah, no, that's great advice. So turning to your exit at Rotten Tomatoes, the company was sold in 2004 for what was reported as around $10 million. One of our audience members, someone who couldn't make it here today, wanted to know what you did with your share of the proceeds. Specifically, how did you spend or invest your money? And I think you talked about that a little bit in terms of what you did in Asia. And did having that amount of money in your possession make you happier than you already were?
So when we sold, I mean, we had three co-founders, we had investors, we also had, every employee had equity. So it wasn't that much, especially after you take out tax. I never really did these things for money. Every company I've done has just been something I thought was interesting at the time, either to do a company or to go to Asia, or a lot of them have been kind of entertainment related. As far as what did I do with it, I moved to Asia. And those next two companies for like 9 years, combined between the two of them, I didn't really take any salary and actually put money into both of those companies. So yeah, just because I'm like, I want to keep, which I don't actually recommend doing. I think it's better if you can try and raise money or just generate revenue so you don't have to put as much in. As far as did it make me happier, I always kind of lived like a college student, and I still basically do. So I guess it's nice, but it wasn't, I don't think it was totally like life-changing. It did make it a little bit easier to not be forced to have to do something I didn't like doing or something like that.
What did your parents do growing up? What kind of careers did they have?
So my dad was a professor. He taught at UCLA, and then he went to teach at University of Maryland, and now he's retired. My mom was a computer programmer, but I think it was back in the day of COBOL, and I think she even used punch cards or something. Like, really long time ago, yeah. And now it's like we still have to help her learn how to use an iPhone, you know.
Okay. And do you have brothers and sisters?
Yeah, I have a younger brother up in Redmond, and he doesn't work at Microsoft, but he is an engineer.
Okay. So before we go to Q&A, I have a theory that I want to run past you. I believe that the notion of entrepreneurship or bust, it's a mindset that's detrimental to one's opportunity for success. My theory is that, and I started and sold an internet company between 97 and 2002, which allowed me to go off and do what I wanted to do, which was to write. My theory is that it's better if you're younger, especially, to go work for a large company first, to go through their hiring process, see how meetings are run, see how office supplies get procured, what's the HR process like, what's the planning process like, and build your business on someone else's balance sheet. What I mean by that is you work for them 8 to 9 to 10 hours a day. The rest of your time is free to noodle on your idea, to pick from this company that you work for the operations that you like and don't like, instead of when you're in college or right after college, throwing all your eggs into one basket and going that route. What do you think about that? Do you think that there's some value in going to work for someone else first and building your business off of their balance sheet?
So my answer is kind of mixed on this. You know, obviously, if you think about what I was just talking about with the opportunity cost, I do feel like, in general, it's better to jump in when you're younger. Especially like when you're straight out of school, if you go and do your own startups for 3 years, you're gonna learn a lot more than working for someone else in 3 years from just getting out of college. A lot of people come out to me, especially straight out of school, and they're like, I was thinking about going to work for someone else first. My experience is probably 98% of those people will never go and do their own startup, because the reason why, it goes back to the irrational confidence, is if they're even saying that, they're basically saying, like, I'm scared to do a startup. I think, oh, I should learn, and they're basically too conservative most of the time. If they really are working and learning from somewhere else and really working on the project on the side, but it's not that easy when you come home from work to have that energy to go and do your own project, if they really do that, that's fine, and that actually can be good. But most of the time when people say, I'm thinking about working first, at least in the Valley, they're usually saying, I'm too conservative. And I had one friend who was saying that back when we were doing our first company, and I would see him a couple years later, he's like, let's get coffee, and he would still say that. And then I went to Asia for 10 years, 9 years, come back, he's like, let's get coffee, and he's still saying that. And I'm like, come on, man, now you're like married with kids, and you've been saying this for like 15 years, like, you're never gonna do it. Go work at a startup if you really wanna see what it's like. As far as when people are older and they have higher opportunity costs, but they really want to, they've been working at companies for years and they really want to do their own thing. The one thing I would look for at that point is, do they have some kind of competitive advantage based on their background and work history to go and do this? Because most of the time the opportunity cost is very high. If they come to me and they're like, they've been doing this one job for 20 years, they've done really well in there, they have a huge network, and then they want to open something completely like 180 different, then I'm generally like, I don't know, that doesn't sound like a good idea. But if it's something based around what they already are good at, they're an expert at, they already have that network, much more than someone who's just jumping in without knowing anything, then I think that case it's okay too.
That's really great advice, thank you. So we've got a great audience here, the room is packed, and we've got about 10, 15 minutes left for Q&A. So why don't we turn it over for that? There are microphones, there's one microphone over here, and is there one that's traveling the room as well? Sorry, it's kind of hard to see up here. If you have a question, there's a microphone right up here. Don't be shy.
You mentioned when you first started speaking that you were interested in coming to New Orleans to see what our entrepreneurial landscape is like. And I'm just curious, as somebody who's invested in businesses, what are you looking for a rich environment? And how much do state and local incentives, whether it's tax incentives or other hiring incentives, matter in an entrepreneurial community?
As far as like government, local government support, I always think that's good. I don't follow that too closely, so I don't really know too much about that. But as far as what I would look for, generally, I'm looking for traction. I would say that's generally true of companies, I mean, investors in the Bay Area. And again, that's showing that your business is working, that you have users or customers, you have traffic, you can generate revenue. You don't necessarily need all of those things. If any, even one of those things is very, very strong, that's good. Like when you look at some of these things like Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, they just had users, lots and lots and lots of users. They didn't generate revenue or barely any revenue at that point. They were losing a lot of money, but they have such wild growth that it made sense.
So on that note, your companies have either been in Asia or they've been in the Bay Area, Silicon Valley. What kind of attributes would you need in order to have your next startup be in New Orleans, for example? What does this ecosystem need to contain in order for you to feel like, yeah, I could do that here? Access to...
Well, so for me, I ended up, you know, I was doing companies in China and Hong Kong. One thing for those as an example was, what I realized is when I went over there, actually it was more of a lifestyle reason for me that I wanted to see what it was like over there. But a problem I had when I went to China was I was born in the States. Even though I could speak Chinese, I wasn't like fluent. I couldn't really read or write. I can only speak. And culturally, they're totally different. Hong Kong is quite different too. And so there's a lot of stuff where I had to learn. I thought I would go in with advantages based on having done Rotten Tomatoes, but I went there, I actually had no advantages versus someone who was local, someone who had a network there. My network didn't even work over there, really. People didn't know Rotten Tomatoes, or very few. As far as trying to do something here, there'd be similar issues. I don't know culturally how different it is, but you know, Bay Area is, I think, a little bit unique in terms of how positive and supportive they are of doing startups. It's risky, and a lot of other places are not necessarily as supportive for a tech startup of taking that kind of risk. The other thing is just, as far as an ecosystem is concerned, one thing that the Bay Area has done well is they have the whole structure to support startups. It's not just like, even if the population is supportive, the community, they also have all the investors from seed stage all the way till the end. They have a lot of employees, they're like tech people who want to go and work in a tech startup. They have just lots and lots of programs and everything to support it. It's kind of like if you want to go and make a movie, you can make it anywhere, but it's probably easier in Hollywood just because of trying to hire, trying to raise money, trying to get it distributed, similar things over there. So, and one thing they also did really well in the Bay Area was because they had these startups, these tech companies so early, like HP, stuff like that, and then from there, you know, you can have things like Apple come out, and then from there, you know, Google and Facebook, and when they do well, they suddenly have all these millionaires who are then investing into more startups or doing more startups. And then it gets so strong that everyone goes over there. People go over to the Valley to work in tech. People go to Hollywood to go work in film, right? And so it just keeps feeding on itself. So it's like cycles over and over and over. So one thing I think for here that would really help is try and find some good companies and really support the hell out of them until they get really huge and they become like a tree. And then they're going to drop some seeds down. They're going to sprout into new businesses. So that, I would say, from a government or from a community standpoint, is probably the most important thing, is really push them all the way up, as big as they can get, and they will then sprout new businesses and companies.
Please.
How you doing? I have a question about, I guess for lack of a better term, gap analysis. Looking into the development of software and even as far as big data, there seem to be a lot of people doing a lot of things. But I want to understand how to define where the gaps are and where to develop a company so it fits in a niche that isn't already saturated.
So I think a lot of times with these, with any company, it is useful to look to see where is it saturated, where is it not. But one thing I actually, my advice, and it could be wrong, but what I believe is not to research too long. I actually think, at least for tech, I'm like, spend three days to a week researching on the business you want to try and do. Don't spend three to 6 months. And the reason why, at least for tech, is because any idea you have, someone has already done it. Probably multiple people have done it, like 95 to 98% exactly the same as your idea. And when you look and look and look, with Google, you can probably find most of those people within 10 minutes, you know. But when you look at it and you find them, what typically they fall into two categories. On the one side, they've done something almost exactly like your idea and it's huge, in which case you're like, well, they're so big, I shouldn't do it. Or on the flip side, they've done your idea and it didn't work. They couldn't pull it off. And you're like, well, they did my idea and it failed. And what's going to happen is, either way, you end up convincing yourself not to do it. The longer you think about it and research it but not actually do it, the more you're going to convince yourself not to do it. And so example is like, if you're Facebook, when you came out, you could have looked at Friendster and said, well, Friendster failed, forget it. Or you could have looked at MySpace at the time that they came out, and you're like, they're huge, forget it. You look at Google, same thing. They could look at Excite, and they're like, well, they're a search engine, and they failed, forget it. Or they could have looked at Yahoo when Google came out. They're so huge, forget it. But they just do it anyways. So if you have an idea, you believe in it a lot, I think just, you should research some, but then just go ahead and do it. And as far as actually trying to see about the niche, the gap, et cetera, my recommendation is when you do it, try to do the simplest version of it for the most likely customer. You know, they talk about MVP, minimum viable product. Make the simplest version to try and get out there to actually see if people are using it. And I also say, like, go for the lowest hanging fruit, the customers that are you think are the best chance to actually use your product. And if you're making the simplest version, targeting the person you're most likely to use it, and they still don't use it, then maybe it doesn't work. But if they do use it, then keep working to see how you can grow those numbers. And the best way to find out if there's a gap somewhere is put it out there and see if it grows.
Yeah, your customers are going to let you know. They're your best test market that you could possibly ever have.
Yeah. So actually having customers using your product is way better than researching for a gap.
Patrick, thank you for being here. I appreciate your talk. My name is Max Walters. I work with Revelry Labs. We're a digital product studio here in New Orleans. And I have two questions. One, very quick. As the business development jack of all trades person on technology teams in Silicon Valley, how did you make yourself valuable so that these other opportunities were there? Because as it's seen from someone who's not there, if you don't have that technical expertise, it's a harder path to create. Secondly, as a leader in tech companies in Silicon Valley, what does it take or what are you thinking about when you consider cities like New Orleans as potential office space, as places where you could expand to? And what would New Orleans need to provide to make that an easy decision for you?
Okay. For the first question, sorry, could you repeat your first question?
Yeah.
I was thinking about the second one.
First question is about your business development role.
Oh, right, right.
In
so for me, I had the advantage of actually doing these startups myself, so I could make sure I was working there. I've actually, besides working part-time jobs, I've never actually worked in a corporate environment. I don't know if they would hire me because I'm not an engineer, I'm not a graphic artist, I'm not exactly a salesperson. I kind of fill in the gaps. But I think when you're doing a startup, there's so many things that are happening, there's so many fires that you always have to have someone that kind of holds it together, is a glue, tries to establish the culture, et cetera. So at least in my case, that was very valuable. The one, I guess, disadvantage of my skill set is I always have to have like a CTO, a technical co-founder, if I'm going to be doing tech. Whereas you look at someone like Mark Zuckerberg or some of these people who essentially they were the technical person first and then they could pick up the business skills later. And that's a lot easier of a transition than the other way around. If you're a business person and you suddenly want to be a programmer too, not that easy. As far as the second part about whether or not like how what you would need to expand to New Orleans, I would say basically if you're doing it here, is there a customer base here, depending on what it is, the product, you know, that would use the product here? Are there the people, like employees, that could actually, for whatever function it is, it's sales, if it's engineering, that you can hire in this area, whether or not the city is very friendly from tax, zoning, whatever kind of rules. The other thing is if there's a good school that can supply, you know, students and talent into that match what you're looking for.
Yeah, probably also the mechanism for funding as well. A really well-developed funding base from seed all the way through to the different rounds that you would need as well.
Yeah, definitely if you're doing a startup, yes. If you're expanding here, probably the funding isn't as important as whether or not you can hire, whether or not it's easy to establish like an office space and things like that.
One more?
Worst practices. I love hearing
anything you know about when you look at a startup, you know, you're looking at a big group of them, even in China, another country, and you just cringe because you're like, I already see it. I already see it's going to just blow up. Like, what those are.
So worst practices when you're doing your own company? One thing, and I've done it myself multiple times, but I see it all the time, is, or two things I think is, one, putting in your own money can be very risky. A lot of times no one else will, you're running around pitching it and no one will do it, so you just put your own money in, and that's admirable, but getting your business to a point where people will put in money or is really important or useful. When you put your own money in, sometimes you won't follow what's actually happening. Like, it's not going that well, and you're just like, I'm just going to keep dumping money in. So that's one thing that's kind of dangerous. Related, raising money from friends and family is also kind of tricky, because if you can't raise from strategic angel investors or venture capital, whatever, it might mean the risk is really high. And then if you then go and raise it from friends and family who are, might not be able to identify that risk, it could be hard, because when it does, if it doesn't work out, it can really hurt your relationships. The other thing is, for people who end up raising too much money or a lot of money, they sometimes prematurely start trying to scale. They start hiring before they've actually proven that the product, it works and people want it and are willing to pay. They start hiring like crazy, and you see it even in the Valley, like, all the time. And they have just way too much headcount relative to how fast they're growing, how many users, all that kind of stuff, how much revenue they're bringing in. And then they basically end up spending themselves to the point where the numbers aren't there, they can't raise more money, they go out of business, or they have to raise at like a much reduced valuation. And so those are like some ones I see a lot.
Yeah, for me, it's one of a management philosophy of operating in a vacuum. The folks that are in the room today are not the ones that I'm talking about. They're the ones that have chosen to come out, to leave the office, to see what they can learn from someone else. The ones that aren't here, because they believe, truly, truly believe, that they have nothing to gain from anyone else. They won't join their industry trade association. They won't go to user conferences. They won't come to events like this, because they believe that they are already the quintessential entrepreneur. Those are the things that drive me crazy and make me just cringe, because I feel like there's so much to learn. But like you were saying, with, hey, take 3 days to a week to research, you can also become so stale and stagnant by spending your time networking and being out in the community and not running your own business. So there's a happy point between the two.
Yeah, actually, that's a good point I forgot to bring up, is I definitely think you should put some amount of resources in towards networking and building a network. Not all your time, unless you're specifically like business development or strategy, possibly. But yeah, I used to put zero time in, because I was kind of introverted. When I did Rotten Tomatoes, we didn't network at all. We were a website, a technology company for movies. We weren't in LA and we weren't in San Francisco. We were in a place called Emeryville, which is like a little bit away from where all the stuff was happening. And we were just happily working on a site, which was good. We made a good product. But when we had a chance to sell, you know, we didn't really have a network to tell us, like, is this a good time to sell, to help find other buyers, to get competitive bids, et cetera. And after we did that, after we sold the company, what I realized later was, I failed as a CEO of the company, because I didn't put any effort in networking. Actually, all three of us were very, three co-founders were very introverted. And ever since then, I've made it a much bigger point to actually build a network for the case where in the future I had another opportunity like that. And so I've really gone out of my way to, you know, go out and meet people, give advice, network with folks, speak at conferences. I even run a private tech group for tech founders, about 130 founders that are all have achieved like a certain level of success, specifically to kind of create this like support network for myself, but also for everyone else involved to help share information, all that stuff, which is why I think like the video with Goldman Sachs was so useful. Like programs like that, I think, are very useful. Like, building a network is very, very useful.
So, Patrick, last question. It's now 12, 13 years removed from the sale of Rotten Tomatoes. Do you ever look back on that and have a regret and say, if we had just held onto that property, the asset value would have increased so dramatically that if we attempted to sell it in this economy, we would have done so much better? Do you have regrets like that? Does that keep you awake at night at all? Or do you feel like you got out at the right time at the right price?
I mean, obviously, looking back, yes, if we had held on to it longer, it would have done better. But again, I think for me, the biggest takeaway was just not having that network, not just focusing too much on just building the company, building the product, which is important. As far as for what happened with us back then, one thing to take into account is we raised money in January 2000. 2 months later was the dot-com bubble burst. And it was, for tech, I don't think it ever was worse than that. Like 2008 was nothing compared to 2004 tech. On top of that, so we immediately had to take our team from our design firm that we brought over, like 25 people, we could go to 17, 14, 11, and down to 7, all in the course of a year. Even when we were at 7, everyone took a 30% pay cut. Two of us went to 0, including myself. I lived under my desk for 6 months to help keep the lights on. A year and a half after the market crashed, 9/11, which was the worst terrorist attack on American soil ever, I think. So between those two events, we were kind of shell-shocked. Like, all we were thinking about was like just survive. And when we, for us, as far as selling, our only criteria to sell was, can we get our investors their money back? It wasn't like, hey, let's make them 10x, 100x. We're just like, they lost all their money in every other investment that they made around that time. And so I think for us, our thinking was different. Had we had Rotten Tomatoes pre-2000 or post, you know, 2005, you know, taking away 2008, yeah, of course it would be better. We sold at a weird time. But again, these things are hard to predict. If we had a good network, maybe we would have had a better idea of timing and things like that. But when we were just working in a vacuum by ourselves, we had no idea about timing.
Yeah, hindsight is always 20/20. Well, Patrick, on behalf of Idea Village, New Orleans Entrepreneur Week, and Goldman Sachs 10,000 Businesses, thank you for coming to New Orleans. We hope that you have an opportunity to take a look around before you have to go back. And will you be available afterwards to answer some questions and meet folks off stage?
Yeah, so I'll stay around here for 20, 30 minutes. I'm going to be around between lunch and dinner, just wandering, just look for the shirt, you know. And I'll be here tomorrow as well. I think I'm helping a judge for the big idea. At night tomorrow. So just come and say hi. And thanks, Michael. Thanks, David, Victoria, Amber, Emily, everyone for having me here.
Outstanding. Thank you, everyone.